The morning sun glinted off the sleek, bullet-shaped fuselage of the Bell X-1 as it sat poised on the runway at Muroc Army Air Field. It was October 14, 1947, and inside the cramped cockpit, Captain Chuck Yeager ran through his pre-flight checks with practiced precision. His square jaw was set with determination, belying the gravity of the mission ahead. The 24-year-old pilot had already made a name for himself as a fearless flying ace in World War II. But today, a new challenge lay ahead, one that many believed impossible, to fly faster than the speed of sound. Yeager's hands moved deftly over the controls, his keen eyes scanning the cloud of dials and gauges before him. The X-1's design was a marvel of aeronautical engineering, its form following function with ruthless efficiency. Every inch of space not occupied by the pilot himself was crammed with fuel, wiring, or instrumentation. As Yeager settled into his seat, he could feel the latent power of the 6,000-pound thrust rocket engine at his back, ready to hurl man and machine into the unknown. The significance of this flight was not lost on the young pilot from West Virginia. If successful, it would mark a watershed moment in aviation history, arguably as important as the Wright brothers' first powered flight at Kitty Hawk. Yet a shadow of doubt lingered. Some experts warned of a so-called sound barrier, an invisible wall in the sky that could tear any aircraft to pieces. A year before, British test pilot Geoffrey de Havilland Jr. had lost his life before ever reaching Mach 1. As Yeager prepared to push the throttle forward, he knew he was about to challenge not just the laws of physics, but the very limits of human endeavor. The quest to break the sound barrier did not begin with the Bell X-1. World War II heralded the introduction of increasingly faster aircraft as nations pushed themselves to compete with their rivals' technology. In 1942, the British government's aviation department initiated a classified program in collaboration with Miles Aircraft with the ambitious goal of creating the first aircraft capable of traveling beyond the speed of sound. This endeavor led to the development of the Miles M-52, a jet-powered aircraft designed to achieve unprecedented speeds. The M-52 was engineered to reach an astonishing 1,000 miles per hour in straight and level flight, more than doubling the airspeed record at the time. Additionally, it was designed to ascend to 36,000 feet in just 90 seconds. The aircraft's form was carefully crafted to meet the extreme demands of supersonic flight, with slender wings and a flat horizontal stabilizer. Approval was given for the construction of three M-52 prototypes in 1944. However, by the end of that year, plans were already underway for a different sound barrier-breaking aircraft on the other side of the Atlantic. In March 1945, as World War II continued to rage, the U.S. military's Flight Testing Division, along with NACA, the National Advisory Committee for Aeronautics, the predecessor to NASA, commissioned Bell Aircraft to construct three experimental supersonic planes. The initial requirements called for an aircraft that could attain speeds of 800 miles per hour at an altitude of 35,000 feet, maintaining this performance for up to 5 minutes. This new aircraft, originally known as XS-1 for Experimental Supersonic, required extensive research due to the many unknowns surrounding flight at and beyond the speed of sound. Bell sought input from various government agencies, engine manufacturers, and research institutions, all the while maintaining a high level of secrecy due to concerns about espionage from the United States' new great rival, the Soviet Union. By the end of the year, the design for the XS-1 was complete. The Bell XS-1 took its inspiration from an unlikely source, a 50-caliber bullet known for its stability at supersonic speeds. Yet the similarity was more than superficial. The aircraft's proportions closely mimicked those of the bullet. It had an extraordinarily streamlined and compact fuselage that measured just under 31 feet long, a sharply pointed nose, and a body that maintained a smooth, gradually tapering shape toward the rear. This design minimized air resistance and helped manage the extreme forces encountered near and beyond the sound barrier. The pilot's cockpit was positioned in the XS-1's nose, allowing for good visibility while maintaining the bullet-like profile. It was directly behind a sloped windscreen, whose angle was carefully calculated to withstand the intense pressures of high-speed flight. The cockpit was pressurized to help the pilot breathe at extremely high altitudes, and it was also notably cramped, with every cubic inch of the aircraft that wasn't absolutely necessary for the pilot, utilized for fuel, instrumentation, or mechanical components, in order to maximize the power-to-weight ratio and give the aircraft a better chance of achieving supersonic speeds. Perhaps surprisingly, for such an experimental aircraft, there was no ejection seat, a result of the lack of space and the need to maintain the aircraft's precise shape and weight distribution. At the time of the XS-1's development, the use of swept wings had still not been fully investigated by the United States, so Bell opted to give the aircraft very thin, straight wings with a wingspan of 28 feet and a total wing area of 130 square feet, vital for reducing drag at high speeds. What's more, it had a horizontal stabilizer that was adjustable in flight, a novel feature recommended by NACA in order to accommodate the significant longitudinal trim changes predicted during transonic flight. After evaluating various propulsion options, Bell opted for a rocket-powered design. Jet engines were deemed inadequate for achieving the desired performance at high altitudes, and a hybrid jet-rocket system was considered too complex and bulky. So the XS-1 design team chose to use a groundbreaking four-chamber rocket engine developed by Reaction Motors Incorporated, a pioneer in liquid-propelled rocket technology in the United States. Several different types of fuel were assessed, including hydrogen peroxide, a mixture of aniline and nitric acid, and nitromethane. Eventually, water-diluted ethyl alcohol was chosen, with liquid oxygen as the oxidizer. A key feature of this engine was its ability to modulate thrust by activating or deactivating individual chambers, allowing for power adjustments in 1,500-pound increments. The initial XS-1 design employed nitrogen-pressurized fuel and oxygen tanks, which, while reducing flight duration by approximately 90 seconds and adding 2,000 pounds to the landing weight, proved effective. As the XS-1 was originally considered for potential use as a fighter, it was designed to take off from the ground, but as World War II finished and the Boeing B-29 Superfortress became available, it was decided instead to use it as a mothership to carry the XS-1 to the chosen altitude. By early 1946, the XS-1 was ready to take to the skies, and on January 19th, Bell Chief Test Pilot Jack Willems performed the aircraft's first unpowered glide flight at Pine Castle Army Air Field in Florida, which was chosen for its long runway and relative seclusion, as the project was still highly classified. It would be the first of 9 glide flights completed by Willems at Pine Castle. Shortly afterward, the project benefited from an unexpected source of information when the British government decided to cancel the Miles M-52, likely for budgetary reasons, opting to create 3 unmanned 1/3-scale models of the aircraft instead. Subsequently, they shared all their research data with Bell, providing valuable insight to the American team, who made further modifications to the XS-1 after it was returned to Bell's headquarters in Buffalo, New York, in March 1946, in preparation for powered flight. While Willems had been envisioned as the pilot who would eventually take the aircraft to supersonic speeds, on August 30th of that year, tragedy struck when he lost his life after crashing a modified P-39 into Lake Ontario during practice for the National Air Races. The following month, news arrived of another lethal accident. British test pilot Geoffrey de Havilland Jr., son of the famous aircraft designer, had lost his life while testing his father's company's DH-108 when it unexpectedly broke up at high, though subsonic, speeds, leading to further questions about the safety of the Bell project. Nevertheless, testing of the XS-1 continued, with Willems succeeded as primary test pilot by Chalmers Slick Goodlin, who completed the aircraft's first powered flight on December 9, 1946, at Muroc Army Air Field near Palmdale, California. Bell's lead test pilot and program manager, Tex Johnston, took the controls for a flight on May 22, 1947, following frustration over the slow progress of testing. Bell's contract with the military specified their role as verifying onboard systems, assessing handling qualities, evaluating stability and control, and conducting performance tests up to Mach 0.99. After his initial flight, reaching Mach 0.72, Johnston believed the aircraft was prepared for supersonic attempts once the pitch trim mechanism was adjusted, recommending just 3 additional test flights. However, the Army Air Force's patience with Bell's cautious approach to expanding the flight envelope had worn thin. Further exacerbating tensions, Goodlin had requested a $150,000 bonus should he successfully break the sound barrier, equivalent to over $2 million in 2024, a sum the USAAF was not prepared to pay. Following extended negotiations, they terminated Bell's flight test contract with the 1st XS-1 on June 24th, and the USAAF Flight Test Division assumed control of the test program. Meanwhile, plans were made for NACA to conduct flight tests with the 2nd XS-1, aiming to gather design data for future high-performance aircraft development. In July, the aircraft was redesignated as the X-1, reflecting the new standardized naming procedure, and in the process, officially becoming the 1st X-plane, a series of cutting-edge experimental programs that has continued into the 21st century. With Bell no longer in control, the challenge of getting the X-1 to live up to its promise of flying faster than the speed of sound now lay with the Army Air Force and NACA. They gave the task to Captain Chuck Yeager, a 24-year-old pilot known for his exceptional flying skills, who distinguished himself with 11.5 aerial victories in the European theater of World War II, including an Ace in a Day recognition for shooting down 5 enemy aircraft in a single mission. Yeager began flying the X-1 from Muroc in late August 1947, nicknaming the aircraft Glamorous Glennis after his wife. Over the following weeks, he completed a series of test flights to familiarize himself with the aircraft's handling and performance characteristics. By October, he was ready to try and achieve what no man in history had ever achieved, breaking the sound barrier. The date was set for October 14th. It would be the X-1's 50th flight. Just 2 days before Yeager's attempt was scheduled to take place, it was almost thrown into jeopardy when the young pilot suffered a horse-riding accident, cracking 2 ribs and injuring his right hand. However, despite the pain, Yeager was determined to go ahead with the flight as planned. In order for him to do so, project engineer Jack Ridley cleverly sawed off 10 inches from a broomstick and wedged it in the lock of the aircraft's hatch so that the pilot would be able to operate it using his left hand. On that bright Tuesday morning, Glamorous Glennis was released from the modified Boeing B-29 Superfortress at an altitude of 20,000 feet. Yeager then piloted the X-1 upwards to 42,000 feet, accelerating rapidly until a thunderous sonic boom echoed across the Mojave Desert below. Yeager had reached Mach 1.05, equivalent to 700 miles per hour, thus marking the historic moment when a piloted aircraft first exceeded the speed of sound in level flight. Initially, this incredible achievement was kept top secret, but after a leak to a journalist from Aviation Week magazine, the story was published on December 20th, followed by an article in the Los Angeles Times 2 days later. The Air Force, which had changed its name from the Army Air Force in September of that year, displeased with this unauthorized disclosure, warned of potential legal consequences for the reporters involved, though no such action materialized. The revelation of a conventional straight-winged aircraft achieving supersonic speeds surprised many U.S. experts, who had shared the prevailing belief held by the Germans during World War II that a swept-wing design would be essential for surpassing the sound barrier. While the Bell X-1 had been designed with the specific goal of proving supersonic flight to be possible, achieving that objective did not signal the end of the project. Subsequent models were designed to push the boundaries of supersonic flight even further. These later variants aimed to explore various aspects of high-speed, high-altitude flight, focusing on aerodynamic phenomena, stability, structural loads, and thermal effects. The X-1A, for instance, was developed to investigate speeds beyond Mach 2 and altitudes exceeding 90,000 feet. This aircraft, longer and heavier than its predecessor, achieved significant milestones. Chuck Yeager once again broke the speed record when he reached Mach 2.44 in level flight on December 12, 1953. However, the X-1A also demonstrated the dangers of inertia coupling, a dangerous, then unknown phenomenon. A mismatch between the aircraft's rotational motion and its mass distribution caused the aircraft to spin out of control. Exposed to accelerations of up to 8G, Yeager broke the canopy with his helmet before finally being able to get the flight back on track. Meanwhile, the X-1B was equipped with extensive thermal instrumentation, contributing valuable data on aerodynamic heating. It also pioneered the use of small reaction rockets for directional control, a system later implemented in the X-15. The X-1C was canceled before completion, yet its intended purpose of testing armaments at high speeds reflects the program's broad scope. The X-1D, though short-lived, was designed for heat transfer research and featured an improved fuel system. Finally, the X-1E, a reconstruction of the second XS-1 incorporated significant modifications, including a new wing profile, improved cockpit design, and extensive instrumentation for aerodynamic and structural data collection. This variant aimed to achieve speeds approaching Mach 3. Throughout the program, these aircraft encountered various challenges, including explosions and structural issues, which led to valuable lessons in high-speed aircraft design and safety. Despite these setbacks, the X-1 variants collectively advanced the understanding of supersonic flight, contributing crucial data on aerodynamics, propulsion, materials, and control systems that would inform the design of future high-performance aircraft. Through its historic breaking of the sound barrier and subsequent research, the Bell X-1 program revolutionized aviation and laid the groundwork for the supersonic age, forever changing our understanding of high-speed flight and pushing the boundaries of what was possible in the sky. Today, Yeager's glamorous Glennis is on display at the Stephen F. Udvar-Hazy Center in Dulles. The X-1B is at the National Museum of the United States Air Force in Ohio, and the X-1E can be seen in front of the NASA Armstrong Flight Research Center headquarters building at Edwards Air Force Base.